Welcome to worship from London.
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Compassionate God, you have fed us with the bread of heaven. Sustain us in our pilgrimage during this Lenten season. May our fasting be hunger for justice, our alms a making of peace, and our prayer the song of grateful hearts. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine all the time. Let it shine. Hallelujah,
this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine.
Hallelujah,
this little light of mine,
this little
I'm gonna let it shine.
Hallelujah, children,
this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine all the time. Let it shine, let it shine.
Everywhere I go,
I'm gonna let it shine.
Everywhere I go,
I'm gonna let it shine.
Everywhere I go,
I'm gonna let it shine. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah,
hallelujah.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine.
Hallelujah,
this little light of mine,
this little
I'm gonna let it shine.
Hallelujah, children,
this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine all the time. Let it shine,
let it shine.
Sing it, children.
Hallelujah,
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 hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah,
hallelujah,
hallelujah, hallelujah,
hallelujah, Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah, sing it hallelujah. This little light up, hallelujah, 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 this little light up. I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, all the time, all the time. Let it shine, let it shine.
Good news from the Gospel of Matthew, the 27th chapter. But the others said, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to Jesus and save him." Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice, and Jesus from the cross breathed his last. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks were split. The tombs also were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. After his resurrection, they came out of the tombs and entered the holy city and appeared to many. Now when the centurion and those with him who were keeping watch over Jesus saw the earthquake and what took place, they were terrified. And they said, "Truly this man was God's son." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
It's all upside down and backwards. It doesn't make any sense, if you think about it at all. I mean, the first people who see Jesus for who he truly is after his death are not the crowds. The crowds just think he's a criminal. And it's not like the religious authorities, it's not like the clergy people of the time, they just think he's a heretic. And it's not the governing authorities, it's not Herod or Pilate, they just think he's a nuisance. It's not even the disciples. The disciples sadly just see him as a disappointment at this point. I mean, a crushing disappointment, but just a disappointment. No, the only ones who truly see Jesus for who he is after his death in that moment are the centurion and the soldiers. I mean, these are not probably the best people. I mean, the centurion is a pretty high officer, but he's a centurion stationed in Jerusalem, kind of a backwater place of mild strategic significance to the Roman Empire. And for the people writing the scriptures, for Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John, for those people, these are the villains. They are enemies. But still, it is the centurion and the soldiers who are not only stationed in Jerusalem, but on this day, they're in charge of the prisoners. And not only in charge of the prisoners, they're in charge of the execution. So the first ones that see Jesus for who he is after his death are the ones who actually hammered the nails into his flesh and actually lifted him up into the sky. They're the ones who actually physically did the killing. Those are the ones who saw Jesus as who he truly is. I mean, again, this is just upside down and backwards. It doesn't make any sense. But if we're honest with ourselves, neither does the cross. The cross does not make any sense, if you think about it. Now, for 2,000 years, we have been thinking about it, and we have been trying to make sense of it, and we've been, you know, we teach it to Sunday school kids, and we teach it in confirmation, so some of you have heard about the cross and us trying to make sense of the cross for your whole lives. And so at a certain point, that the offensiveness of the cross kind of fades away, the nonsense of the cross kind of disappears, and you just start to accept it as something that is part of reality. But if you take a moment and think about what the cross actually means and what happened there, it's just upside down and backwards. Here are some of the things that God does. God lives, God creates, God smites sometimes. God judges, God sees, God knows, God is. And you can take a lot of verbs and put it after God, what God does. The one you never would, because it's nonsense, because it's upside down and backwards, you would never say God dies. And yet that's what the gospel says. That's the story that we've been passing on from generation to generation to generation. That's what Jesus does. Jesus dies on the cross. It's upside down and it's backwards. And not only just a regular death, it is a humiliating death, a shameful death, a death of the lowest possible criminals. It's upside down and it's backwards. And this is frustrating. It's hard for those of us in the church, whether you're, you know, a clergy person or not, it's hard for us who are just a part of the church, because for the last 2,000 years or so, we've been trying to make it make sense. We've been trying to make God make sense. We're trying to make Jesus make sense. We're trying to make it comfortable, trying to make it straightforward, try to fit into this logical pattern that makes us feel safe. And so we build these structures, these amazing architectural structures, and we fill them with beautiful music. And we put these patterns to it, these nice, logical, consistent patterns, so that every time we show up on a Sunday morning or Wednesday night, we know what to expect. And it makes us feel comfortable, and it makes us feel safe, and it makes us feel like the world has some order in the midst of the chaos. We do this with our whole lives, even. I mean, you start in childbirth, and then you have baptism, and then you go to Sunday school, and then you have confirmation, and then you go and you have your vocation, and then you get married, and then you maybe start the process over again, many people. You have children, and so you go through baptism, and you keep doing that cycle until the end, and then you die, and then there's a funeral. There's a system to it. There's a process. There's a pattern. And it all feels straightforward. And it all feels like it makes sense. And it makes us feel comfortable and good and safe. But as soon as we really think we've got God figured out, as soon as we really think we've got God in a nice box that's ordered, maybe has a bow on top, well, then God goes and gets born in a barn. And as soon as we think we've got God understood, then Jesus goes and spends all his time with tax collectors and sinners and people who would just shock us. As soon as we think that we have God just put together just so, just nicely, so it all just fits together in perfect harmony, Jesus dies a shameful death on the cross. No, it's all upside down and backwards. And it's hard for us who want to control God, who want to think that we have some say in what God does. However, for those whose lives have some chaos in them, for those who feel like the outsider, for those who feel broken deep inside, for those whose world is upside down and backwards, for them, for us, this is nothing but good news. Because we can then declare with everyone who feels broken, with all the sinners across space and time, with all of the outsiders, with all of the people whose lives are turned around, that truly this man is God's son. Amen.
day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We would like to thank everyone for the financial support you have given to United Lutheran Church here in Red Wing. The options in giving are to text and go on the mail at on the, to the church, or go to our website. The fourth choice is come and worship with us. We have a wonderful staff here, a great congregation with lots of activities. So come and be a part of our faith journey. Blessings to you.
People of God, just a friendly reminder that this upcoming week is the beginning of Holy Week. We start with Palm Sunday, which is a big processional. We have lots of fun things planned for those services, which are at 7:30, 8:30, as well as 10:15. And the following week is Holy Week, where we have a Maundy-Thursday service. That's where the service we remember the Last Supper, as well as the betrayal of Jesus. Good Friday service is at 6:30, as is Maundy-Thursday. Good Friday is about the crucifixion and sacrifice of Jesus. And most importantly of all, we have Easter services planned. We have brass, we have a lot of festivities planned, so those will be at our normal times. But if you'd prefer to worship outside for whatever reason, you're welcome to do so. We do have a special service at 9:30 on Sunday morning, Easter morning. That'll be in Central Park. There'll be an Easter egg hunt involved in that. So again, we welcome you to join us, whether it's in person or online, to make Holy Week as special and as meaningful as it should be. Thanks. Bye-bye.
Safety of all who have to leave their homes. We pray for the end of the war and for peace, Lord in mercy, hear our prayer.
Dear God, we ask that you build up our resiliency, optimism, hope, and confidence in God's presence when we feel anxious, overwhelmed, or powerless in today's world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
We give you thanks, O God, for surrounding us with steadfast love and forgiveness that cannot be taken away or diminished by anyone or anything. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
We pray for these members who are having difficulties this week. We pray for Dorothy Quam, Sherry Folkerts, Sylvester Rottering, Lori Meyer, Bob Bowen, Scott Rigg, Norman Adeline Sampson, Holly Robbins, and Connie. Fill them with your hope and your peace and restore their bodies to health. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Longing for light, we wait in darkness. Longing for truth, we turn to you. Make us your own, your holy people, light for the world to see. Christ, we are light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ, we today. Longing for peace, our world is troubled. Longing for hope, many despair.
Serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hi, I'm Jay Wardle, president of the Church Council. I've been with United Lutheran Church since 2015 when my family moved to Red Wing.
I'm Rachel McWithy. I grew up in this church and am now the secretary of the Church Council. We have been coming since we moved back to Minnesota in about 2016.
So I am Stacey Lance, members of the church since 2018. We visited the church for about a year before we joined. I'm currently serving as the vice president of the Church Council. Today we're here to invite you to a congregational meeting on April 10th at 11 a.m. We are holding that meeting to seek approval to upgrade our youth and education spaces in the lower level of the church.
We use these spaces every single day. On our Wednesday night programming, Sunday school on Sundays, we've got Girl Scouts, AA, we have tons of our large groups that show up and are here in these spaces all the time. And so what an opportunity for us to be able to not only provide a wonderful space to inspire our youth to grow up within Jesus Christ, but we're also able to celebrate our rich history that we have here. And so with that, I'd like to introduce you to a few of the spaces that we'll be redefining as a part of this project. Much like a house, we have to focus on regular maintenance to keep things fresh, keep things going, and keep things safe. So a large part of what we'll be doing is doing some new carpeting as well as removal of asbestos just to get us back up to code and making sure that we have a cohesive environment throughout the facility. We'll also be making some updates to our restrooms near the elevator, as well as making sure that the restrooms by the old preschool are removed as they are not up to code. In addition, we're going to be working on making several updates to our youth room and old preschool rooms, as those are spaces that have a ton of use throughout the week. So things like painting, updating our ceiling, getting some new lights, new furniture, as well as adding some new tables for our quilters, removing old furniture, and just making sure that we've got our space cleaned up and ready for those that visit. As you recall, when we started our building renovation project, we decided that we wanted to be really smart with our budget. So we decided to leave this room unfinished because at that time we didn't have a clear purpose. Now we've identified a great purpose for this space specifically. As an opportunity to be able to celebrate the rich history that United Lutheran has, we want to be able to offer a space to hold our archives. So members can come see the rich history that we have, and enjoy all of the work that our archives team has put in.
So to give a little bit of context here, we've been on a multi-year journey to upgrade our facilities and infrastructure and meet the fundamental needs like the new elevator and enhancing the appearance of our worship and education spaces. The addition project and the capital campaign we did several years ago made a big move on this. However, to keep that project budget and our mortgage reasonable, a lot of things were sort of put to the side so that we could meet the core needs of the new elevator and closing those steps for icy winter days and creating some blank spaces for some new opportunities. That has been very successful, and we are years ahead of paying that mortgage down. Along the way, the congregation has also continued to give on top of that. And so we remain in a strong financial position to take some of these shelved projects and actually go after them over several years. Last year, for example, we took the opportunity to re-carpet the sanctuary while we all couldn't be in the sanctuary. So that was a good opportunity to take there. This year, a proposal was brought to council to really reimagine the space down here in the basement for our youth and our education. And so what we want to do is create a more inspiring place for them for their future. So, but what we've also recognized is that we should really create what I'm calling a multi-year roadmap of our investments like these. And so the council will be putting that together over the coming first half of the year. And so we'll lay that out to say, here's all of the things we'd like to do, and here's maybe how that might stretch out over several years, and here's how we think we can financially pay for them, so that it creates clarity for everybody how and when we'll be actually be doing our other projects. So with that, we do think this is the best project for our congregation right now, and we ask that you join us on April 10th at 11 a.m. to discuss and vote on this project. Thank you for your time.